Welcome to English Guru YouTube channel. Please click the red subscribe button and press the bell icon to receive all notifications about my new video lectures. Good morning students. Once again I welcome you to the English Guru YouTube channel. In this video lecture I'll discuss top 118 most important frequently asked questions in the TGT, PGT and UGC NET exams. Okay, now let's start. Question number 1. Point out the figure of speech in the following line. The ploughman homeward plods his weary way. The poetic device used in this line is transport epithet. It's a figure of speech in which an epithet or qualifying adjective is sometimes transferred from a person to an object or from word to another. Question number 2. To which character in Shakespeare's Hamlet does the following description apply? The tedious wiseacre who meddles his way to his tomb. This description is for Hamlet, a character in the play Hamlet written by William Shakespeare. So here option 2 will be correct, Hamlet. Question number 3. Who wrote Sohrab and Rustam? Sohrab and Rustam is a narrative poem with strong tragic themes, first published in 1853 by Matthew Arnold. So here option 3, Matthew Arnold, will be correct. Question number 4. Who praised Shakespeare thus? Others abide by our question, thou art free. We ask and ask, thou smilest and art still. So these lines are taken from the poem Shakespeare by Matthew Arnold. This poem is a sonnet written in tribute to Shakespeare. So here the correct option will be second option, Matthew Arnold. Question number 5. Who is Thyrsis in the poem of the same name? So let me explain this question. Arthur Hugh Clough, a poet and disciple of Dr. Thomas Arnold, was the closest friend of Matthew Arnold when they were young. Matthew Arnold later on mourns about Arthur Hugh Clough in his elegy Thyrsis. So your correct option will be second option, Arthur Hugh Clough. Let's see question number 6. Which of the following novels of Dickens was left unfinished? So Charles Dickens' novel The Mystery of Edwin Drood is the final novel. This novel was unfinished at the time of Dickens' death on 9 June 1870. So your right option will be third option, that is The Mystery of Edwin Drood. Question number 7. Nazim Ezekiel's poem Background Casually Reflects. So let me explain this. Nazim Ezekiel's autobiographical poem Background Casually reflects his feeling alienation, discrimination and fortune which he had to bear in his childhood. So your right option will be first option, his feeling alienation, is correct. Question number 8. Point out the figure of speech in the following. Little sorrows sit and weep. So this is an example of personification. It's a figure of speech in which human qualities are attributed to animals, inanimate objects or ideas. Okay, now let's see question number 9. Frederick Henry, the hero of Hemingway's novel A Farewell to Arms, is a driver in. So in Hemingway's novel A Farewell to Arms, Frederick Henry, the hero, is a driver in an Italian army and he there supervises a group of Italian ambulance drivers. So here the right option will be first option, Italian army. Okay, now let's see question number 10. Who is the author of The Unvanquished? So the author of Unvanquished is William Cuthbert Faulkner. It was published in 1938. It tells the story of Sartori's family who first appeared in the novel Sartori's. Here Sartori's is a novel first published in 1929 by William Faulkner. Here the correct answer is given in option 4, that is William Cuthbert Faulkner. Question number 11. Santiago is the hero of Hemingway's novel. Here Santiago is the hero of the novel The Old Man and the Sea, written by Ernest Hemingway. It was the last novel of Hemingway. It was published in 1951 before his death. For this novel, Hemingway got Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in 1953 and the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1954. Here the right option will be second option, that is The Old Man and the Sea. Question number 12. What was the origin of the race of Nizam Ezekiel? So Nizam Ezekiel belonged to Mumbai's Jewish community known as the Ben Israel. So here option first will be correct, Ben Israel. Question number 13. In which year did Robert Frost sell his farm in New England and move to England? So in 1912, Robert Frost sold his farm and moved to England. So here option third is correct, 1912. Some other facts about Robert Frost that I would like to mention here are, Robert Frost published his first full book of poetry, A Boy's Will, in 1913, and in 1914 another book of poetry, North of Boston, appeared. This made Frost's reputation as a poet. Question number 14. Who has called Shelley a perfect singing god? So the poet Algernon Charles Swinburne, an English poet, playwright, novelist, critic, and a great promoter of Shelley, wrote, he was the perfect singing god. His thoughts, words, deeds all sung together. A.C. Swinburne also wrote several novels and collections of poetry such as Poems and Ballads, published in 1866, contributed to the famous 11th edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica. So your right option is first option, A.C. Swinburne. A.C. Swinburne called Shelley a perfect singing god. Okay, question number 15. Muno is the central character of Mulk Raj Anand's novel. Here Muno is the central character in the novel Coolie, written by Mulk Raj Anand. So here option first, Coolie is the correct option. Okay, now let's see question number 16. Who said the poet is a man speaking to men? So William Wordsworth, in the preface to the Lyrical Ballads, published in 1798, described that a poet is a man speaking to men. So here option 4th, William Wordsworth, will be the correct option. Question number 17. The romantic poetry is a revival of. So let me explain this. Romanticism in English literature began in the 1790 with the time of Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge. It can be seen as a rejection of the percepts of order, calm, harmony, balance, idealization, and rationality that typified classicism. In other words, the Romantic movement is termed as revival of form or creations of new forms. So here option first, classicism will be the correct option. Question number 18. The Dance of Eunuchs has been written by. So the Dance of Eunuch is a poem composed by Kamala Das. This poem has an autobiographical element written in confessional style that symbolically portrays the poetess' personal melancholy in her life. This poem is a part of collection Summer in Calcutta published by Kamala Das in 1965. So your correct option will be third option, Kamala Das. The Dance of Eunuchs has been written by Kamala Das. Okay. Question number 19. How many times did Robert Frost win the prestigious Pulitzer Prize? So Robert Frost won the prestigious Pulitzer Prize 4 times for his work New Hampshire in 1924, Collected Poems in 1931, A Further Rains in 1937, and A Witness Tree in 1943. So here no option is correct. Question number 20. The rest is silence. These are the last words of before his death in Shakespeare. So these are the last words spoken by Hamlet in Shakespeare's play Hamlet when Hamlet was upon his deathbed. So your option third, Hamlet, is correct. Question number 21. The iambic pentameter implies which of the following? So let me explain this. Iambic pentameter refers to a certain kind of line of poetry. Pent means 5. So a line of iambic pentameter consists of 5 iambs. 5 sets of unstressed syllable followed by stressed syllable. So here option first, 5 syllables in the pattern unstressed stressed will be the correct option. Question number 22. Which work was left incomplete because of Hemingway's sudden death? So the novel The Garden of Eden is the incompleted novel of Ernest Hemingway. It was begun in 1946 and Hemingway worked on the manuscript for the next 15 years. It was published posthumously, means after his death, in 1986. So here right option will be third option, The Garden of Eden. Question number 23. The rhetorical device of anaphora implies which of the following? Here rhetorical means alankari and anaphora means anuvadesh. So anaphora is the repetition of a certain word or phrase at the beginning of successive lines of writing or speech. So here option fourth, repeating the first word or words of successive sentences or clauses will be correct. Question number 24. Which of the following works is not associated with Matthew Arnold? So here option first, Culture and Environment is not the work of Matthew Arnold. In the given options, Arnold's works include only Doberbys, Thyrsis and Empedocles on Etna. So here option first will be correct, Culture and Environment. Question number 25. The Westland was published in the year. So here the correct option is first. The Westland was published in 1922. Question number 26. The Lake District in England is associated with. So let me explain this. The Lake District in England is associated with William Wordsworth. He was born in the town of Cockermouth on 7th April 1770 and his first home was in the Lake District. His great autobiographical poem, The Prelude, traces the growth of the author from his early years, and it seems that the Lake District formed part of his very identity. He died on 23rd April 1850 in Radlemouth, UK. So here option 4th, William Wordsworth will be the correct option. Question number 27. Essays of Elia is. So Charles Lamb's Essays of Elia is a collection of essays. It was first published in book form in 1823. Last Essays of Elia issued in 1833. The essays in the collection first began appearing in the London magazine in 1820 and continued to 1825. Essays of Elia is practically autobiographical fragments. So here option second, practically autobiographical fragments, is the correct option. Question number 28. Milton's Samson Agonistes is. So John Milton's Samson Agonistes is a classical tragedy. It was published in 1671. It's a story of destiny, of heroism, of the fate of a nation and the threat of seduction. So here option 4th, a classical tragedy, is correct. Question number 29. Good fences make good neighbors. This line occurs in which poem of Frost? So this line occurs in the poem Mending Wall, composed by Robert Frost and published in 1914. So here the correct option will be second option, that is Mending Wall. Okay. Question number 30. Which of the following is a work of Ezekiel? So in the given options, the poem A Time to Change is composed by Nizam Ezekiel. This poem was published in 1952. So here the correct option will be first option, A Time to Change. Now let's see question number 31. The name of Macbeth's wife in the Shakespearean play is. So the name of Macbeth's wife is Lady Macbeth, who later becomes the Queen of Scotland. So here option 4th, none of the above, is the correct option. Question number 32. The figure of speech used in the following sentence is, all the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand. So the poetic device hyperbole has been used in this sentence. Hyperbole is a figure of speech in which a statement is made emphatic by overstatement. Okay. Now let's see question number 33. Who first imported sonnet to England? So the sonnet was first imported to England in the early 16th century by Sir Thomas Wyatt. So here option second, Sir Thomas Wyatt, is correct option. Question number 34. Which one of the following theatre companies was owned by Shakespeare where his masterpieces were first performed? So here correct option is second, Globe. It was a theater in London associated with William Shakespeare. It was built in 1599 by Shakespeare's playing company, Lord Chamberlain's Men. It was destroyed by fire on 29th June 1613. A second Globe Theatre was built on the same site by June 1614 and closed by an ordinance in September 1642, passed by the Long Parliament. Okay, now let's see question number 35. To follow knowledge like a sinking star beyond the utmost bound of human thought. Who wrote these lines? So these lines occur in the poem Ulysses, written in 1833 and published in 1842 by Alfred Lord Tennyson. So here option third, Alfred Tennyson, will be the correct option. Question number 36. O God, how weary, stale and unprofitable seems to me all the uses of this world. Which of Shakespeare's tragic heroes utters these words? So let me explain this. These lines occur in the play Hamlet in Act 1st, Scene 2nd, written by William Shakespeare. It's Hamlet's first soliloquy in which Hamlet mourns the death of his late father. He says that the world is weary, stale, flat and unprofitable. In other words, suicide seems like a desirable alternative to life in a painful world. But Hamlet feels that the option of suicide is close to him because it is forbidden by religion. So here option first, Hamlet, will be the correct option. Question number 37. Which of the following novels of Hemingway deals with his actual disappointing experiences of love and war? So here the novel Across the River and Into the Trees deals with Hemingway's actual disappointing experiences of love and war. So here option third will be correct, Across the River and Into the Trees. Question number 38. In Yeats' poem Sailing to Byzantium, Byzantium refers to. So let me explain this. Sailing to Byzantium is a poem by William Butler Yeats. It was first published in the 1928 collection The Tower. This poem comprises four stanzas in ottava rima, is made up of 8-10 syllable lines. It uses a journey to Byzantium, that's Constantinople, as a metaphor for a spiritual journey. So here option first, Constantinople, will be the correct option. Okay, now let's see question number 39. Tennyson's poetry represents. So the Victorian period was a time of contradiction, often referred to as the Victorian Compromise. On one hand, there was the progress brought about by the Industrial Revolution, the rising wealth of the upper and middle classes, and the expanding power of Britain and its empire. On the other hand, there was the poverty, disease, deprivation, and injustice faced by the working classes. Tennyson's poetry represents Victorian Compromise. So here option third, Victorian Compromise, will be the correct option. Question number 40. Who coined the phrase poetry is the criticism of life? So the phrase poetry is the criticism of life is coined by Matthew Arnold. By poetic truth, he meant representation of life in true way. Arnold's viewpoint about poetry is that poetry should deal with ideas, not facts. So here option fourth, Matthew Arnold, is the correct option. Okay, let's see question number 41. Philip Pirrip is a character in Charles Dickens novel. So Philip Pirrip is a character in Charles Dickens novel Great Expectations. It was originally published in 1861. In this novel, the author has created a character called Philip Pirrip or Pip, who is the protagonist of the novel. So your option second is correct, Great Expectation. Question number 42. Who wrote the poem The Triumph of Life? So The Triumph of Life was the last major work by Percy Bysshe Shelley before his death in 1822. This work was left unfinished. It is also known as dark and visionary poem. So here option third, Shelley will be the correct option. Question number 43. Let knowledge grow from more to more, but more of reverence in us dwell. In which poem of Tennyson do we find the above quoted lines? So these lines have been taken from the poem In Memoriam composed by Alfred Lord Tennyson. This poem was dedicated to his former classmate Arthur Henry Hallam. So your option third, In Memoriam, will be the correct option. Question number 44. Who is the most furious character in Fagin's Den in Dickens' Oliver Twist? So Oliver Twist or The Parish Boy's Progress is Charles Dickens' second novel and was first published as a serial from 1837 to 1839. In the novel, Bill Sykes, a fictional character and the main antagonist in the novel, can be rightfully considered as most furious characters in Fagin's Den. So here option 4th, Bill Sykes, will be the correct option. Okay, now let's see question number 45. What can be the best explanation for the character of John Falstaff in Shakespeare's Henry IV? So John Falstaff is a fictional character who is mentioned in 4 plays by William Shakespeare and appears on stage in 3 of them. He is primarily a comic figure, a fat, vain, boastful and cowardly knight. So your correct option is 4th option, that is caricature. Here caricature means a representation of a person that is exaggerated for comic effect. In Hindi it means cartoon, hasya chitra ya vyang chitra. Okay, now let's see question number 46. In which play of Shakespeare do the characters Voltimand and Cornelius appear? So Voltimand and Cornelius are the courtiers in the play Hamlet, whom Claudius sends to Norway to persuade the king to prevent 14 brothers from attacking. So here the correct option will be second option, that is Hamlet. Question number 47. Keats' poetry is abundantly and enchantingly sensuous. Who has made this comment about the poetry of Keats? So this is a Matthew Arnold's comment about poetry of Keats. So your option first, Matthew Arnold, will be the correct option. Question number 48. No nightingale did ever chant more welcome notes to weary bands of travelers in some shady haunt among Arabian sands. Where from the above quoted lines of Wordsworth are taken? So these lines occur in the poem Solitary Reaper. So your option first will be correct. Question number 49. In which famous poem does Walt Whitman make a reference to Suez Canal and wire line across the Atlantic? So the famous poem in which Walt Whitman makes a reference to Suez Canal and wire line across the Atlantic is Passage to India. It was originally published in 1870. So here the right option will be second option, Passage to India. Okay. Okay, now let's see question number 50. Which of the following is the first poem of Eliot's first published volume of verse? So the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock, commonly known as Prufrock, is the first professionally published poem by American-born British poet T.S. Eliot. So here option third, the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock will be the correct option. Question number 51. The term essay is the derivative of the French root essay, which means, so essay is derived by way of Middle English from the Middle French essay. The French word itself derived from the late Latin exegium, which means act of weighing, or essay derived from the French infinitive essayer, which means to try or to attempt. So here option third, to try, will be the correct option. Question number 52. Matthew Arnold's Rugby Chapel commemorates. So Rugby Chapel is one of the well-known elegies of Matthew Arnold. In this poem, the poet commemorates his illustrious father, who was a symbol of purity and moral earnestness. His father had influential ideals about Christian education. So here the correct option will be first option, the death of his father. Matthew Arnold, Rugby Chapel commemorates the death of his father. Let's see question number 53. Who has written the essay, The Old Benchers of the Inner Temple? The essay Old Benchers of the Inner Temple is written by Charles Lamb. So here option third is correct. Charles Lamb started his career initially as a poet. The Old Familiar Faces, 1789, remains his best known poem. His finest poetic achievement came in 1828 when he wrote the poem On an Infant Dying as Soon as It Was Born. Okay. Now let's see question number 54. Ernest Hemingway's Men at War is. So Ernest Hemingway, born on 21st July 1899 in Oak Park, Illinois, United States, and died on 2 July 1961 in Ketchum, Idaho, United States. He was an American journalist, novelist, and short story writer, best known for his novels The Sun Also Rises, A Farewell to Arms, and The Old Man and the Sea. In 1953, he won the Pulitzer Prize for his novel The Old Man and the Sea, and he won Nobel Prize in 1954. Here in the given question, Ernest Hemingway's Men at War is a collection of short stories. So here option second will be correct. A collection of short stories. Okay, let's see question number 55. The analogy was that of the catalyst. Here analogy means a comparison between things that have similar features, often used to help explain a principle or idea. And catalyst means a person or thing that causes change. So the analogy was that of the catalyst. When the two gases previously mentioned are mixed in the presence of a filament of platinum, they form sulfurous acid. This acid contains no trace of platinum and the platinum itself is apparently unaffected, has remained inert, neutral and unchanged. The mind of the poet is the shade of platinum. The above lines are an extract from T.S. Eliot's essay. So these lines are an extract from T.S. Eliot's essay, Tradition and Individual Talent. It was first published in The Egoist, a London literary magazine, in 1919 and later in Eliot's first book of criticism, The Sacred Wood, a collection of 20 essays in 1920. So your option 4th will be correct, Tradition and Individual Talent. Question number 56. Choose the misspelled word. The misspelled word is given in option 3rd, that is anomalous. The correct spelling of anomalous will be A-N-O-M-A-L-O-U-S, which means aniyamit, niyam virud, asangat, vilakshan, etc. Question number 57. Find out the correctly spelt word from the following. The correct spelling of concupiscence is given in option 2nd, which means a desire for sexual intimacy. In Hindi it means kam vasna, kamukta, vishay vasna, etc. Question number 58. Find out the correct spelling. So the correct spelling of rheumatic is given in option 1st, which means a person suffering with rheumatism. In Hindi, aam vat rogi, vat rog grast, ya gathiya rog sambandhit. Question number 59. Which of the following is the correct spelling? So the correct spelling of irreconcilable is given in option 3rd, which means impossible to reconcile. In Hindi, asangat, paraspar virodhi, bemel, kattar virodhi, ya samjhaute ke ayogya. Okay, now let's see question number 60. Choose the correct meaning of the word peruse. Here pursue is written, it should be peruse, P-E-R-U-S-E. So the word peruse means to read thoroughly, examine or consider with attention and in detail. So here the correct meaning of the word peruse, P-E-R-U-S-E, will be third option, to read thoroughly. Question number 61. Choose the correct word to fill in the blanks in the sentence given below. Wordsworth was a great lover of natural scenery and, so here the correct option is third option, that is sight, S-I-G-H-T, which means drishya. And the complete sentence will be, Wordsworth was a great lover of natural scenery and sight. Question number 62. Choose the most appropriate one word substitute for the expression given below. An office with good salary but no work. So here gratis means costing nothing. In Hindi, muft ya bina mulya ka. Honorary means alabhkar, avaitnik, manad, etc. Discretionary means vivekgat, vivekadhin, ya swanirnayagat. Sinecure means aram ki naukri, ya daityahin pad. An office that involves minimal duties. So here an appropriate one word for the expression an office with good salary but no work will be option 4th, sinecure. Here sinecure means aram ki naukri ya दायित्वहीन पद, एन ऑफिस दैट इन्वॉल्व्स मिनिमल ड्यूटीज। लेट्स सी क्वेश्चन नंबर 63। चूज द करेक्ट मीनिंग ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इडियम आउट ऑफ द फोर ऑप्शंस गिवन आफ्टर इट। ब्लैक एंड ब्लू, द इडियम ब्लैक एंड ब्लू मीन्स इन अ सीवियर मैनर टू बीट और पिंच अंटिल फ्लेश इज डिसकलर्ड। इन हिंदी इट मीन्स चोट से नीला पड़ा हुआ। सो द करेक्ट मीनिंग ऑफ ब्लैक एंड ब्लू विल बी इन अ सीवियर मैनर। ऑप्शन सेकेंड इज करेक्ट। क्वेश्चन नंबर 64। चूज द मोस्ट अप्रोप्रिएट वन वर्ड सब्स्टिट्यूट फॉर द एक्सप्रेशन गिवन बिलो, अ सपोर्टर ऑफ द कॉज ऑफ वेमेन। सो हियर फेमिनिन मीन्स स्त्री संबंधी, स्त्रीयोचित, स्त्रीलिंग एटसेट्रा। फेमिनिस्ट मीन्स अ सपोर्टर ऑफ फेमिनिज्म, इन हिंदी स्त्रीवादी, नारीवादी। एंड इफेमिनेट मीन्स हैविंग अनसुटेबल फेमिनिन क्वालिटीज, मीन्स नारी जैसा। सोफिस्ट मीन्स समवन हुज रीजनिंग इज सबटल एंड ऑफन स्पेसियस, इन हिंदी कुतर्की या मिथ्या हेतुवादी। सो हियर वन वर्ड फॉर द एक्सप्रेशन अ सपोर्टर ऑफ द कॉज ऑफ वेमेन विल बी ऑप्शन सेकेंड, फेमिनिस्ट। लेट्स सी क्वेश्चन नंबर 65। चूज द करेक्ट वर्ड फॉर द एक्सप्रेशन गिवन बिलो, अ रूम फॉर द डिस्प्ले ऑफ वर्क्स ऑफ आर्ट। सो हियर वन वर्ड फॉर द एक्सप्रेशन अ रूम फॉर द डिस्प्ले ऑफ वर्क्स ऑफ आर्ट विल बी ऑप्शन थर्ड, गैलरी, जी ए एल एल ई आर वाई। नाउ लेट्स सी क्वेश्चन नंबर 66। सिलेक्ट द बेस्ट चॉइस टू रिप्लेस द अंडरलाइंड एक्सप्रेशन इन द फॉलोइंग सेंटेंस। आदित्य वॉज नॉट सिलेक्टेड फॉर द जॉब ऑफ अ मेडिकल ऑफिसर बिकॉज ही वॉज वेट बिहाइंड द ईयर्स। सो यर वेट बिहाइंड द ईयर्स मीन्स इन एक्सपीरियंस्ड। सो ऑप्शन सेकेंड विल बी करेक्ट। क्वेश्चन नंबर 67। विथ अ हाई हैंड मीन्स, सो यर विथ अ हाई हैंड मीन्स अहंकार से, घमंड से या गुस्ताखी से। सो यर द राइट ऑफ मीनिंग ऑफ विथ अ हाई हैंड विल बी ऑप्शन सेकेंड, इन अ डिक्टेटोरियल वे। क्वेश्चन नंबर 68। विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग मीन्स अ शार्लटन। सो शार्लटन मीन्स इम्पोस्टर, चीट और प्रिटेंडर, इन हिंदी ढोंगी, कपटी या मायावी व्यक्ति। सो द करेक्ट मीनिंग ऑफ शार्लटन इन द गिवन ऑप्शंस विल बी ऑप्शन फर्स्ट, हु प्रिटेंड्स टू हैव मोर स्किल देन ही रियली हैज। ओके, क्वेश्चन नंबर 69। द अप्रोप्रिएट मीनिंग ऑफ एल डोरेडो इज, हियर एल डोरेडो मीन्स एन अनअटेनेबल थिंग, अ प्लेस दैट एग्जिस्ट ओनली इन इमेजिनेशन। सो द राइट ऑप्शन विल बी थर्ड ऑप्शन, एन अनअटेनेबल थिंग। क्वेश्चन नंबर 70। फिल इन द ब्लैंक विथ अप्रोप्रिएट वर्ड, द ट्री वॉज विथ फ्रूट्स। सो हियर द करेक्ट ऑप्शन इज थर्ड ऑप्शन, दैट इज लेडन, विच मीन्स फिल्ड विथ अ ग्रेट क्वांटिटी। एंड द कंप्लीट सेंटेंस विल बी लाइक दिस, द ट्री वॉज लेडन विथ फ्रूट्स। नाउ लेट्स सी क्वेश्चन नंबर 71। विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग सेंटेंस इज अ करेक्ट वन। सो हियर द करेक्ट सेंटेंस इज गिवेन इन ऑप्शन सेकेंड, लेट द शिप गो इट्स एंकर। Question number 72. Find out the correct conversation of the following direct speech into indirect narration. Please, please don't think too much. Remember that you will have to drive home, she said to him. Here the correct indirect speech of given direct speech will be second option. She begged him not to drink too much, reminding him that he would have to drive home. Question number 73. Which of the given options is the correct indirect form of speech of the following sentence? Wish you a happy journey, Nita said to me. Here the correct indirect form of speech of the sentence, wish you a happy journey, Nita said to me, will be Nita wished me a happy journey. So here option second is correct. Question number 74. Point out the correct indirect form of the mother said, do not go out in rain. So the correct indirect form of the direct speech, the mother said, do not go out in rain will be fourth option. Mother forbade her to go out in rain. Question number 75. Complete the following sentence with appropriate word. Please refer to the subject above. Here the correct option will be third option. Cited. C-I-T-E-D. Cite means to mention something as an example, especially one that supports, proofs or explains an idea or situation. The complete sentence will be like this. Please refer to the subject cited above. Question number 76. He jumped off the bus while it. Here the correct option will be second option, was moving. He jumped off the bus while it was moving. Question number 77. Which of the following sentence is correct? So here the correct sentence is given in option second, that is, full many a flower is born to blush unseen. We always use singular verb with many a and more than one. For example, many a man was killed. Second example, more than one boy was absent. Okay, let's see question number 78. I am looking forward to, here the correct option is second option, that is seeing my friend. I am looking forward to seeing my friend. Question number 79. The gardens in Srinagar are more beautiful than, here the correct option will be fourth option, those of Mysore. The gardens in Srinagar are more beautiful than those of Mysore. Now let's see question number 80. Fill in the blanks in the following sentence with correct preposition. My friend came all the way from Kathmandu to congratulate me my success. Here the correct preposition will be on. My friend came all the way from Kathmandu to congratulate me on my success. Question number 81. Which of the following sentence is correct one? So here the sentence given in option 2. I went there with a view to meeting him is correct. We always use gerund, that is gerund form, that is verb first form plus ing with the phrase with a view to. Question number 82. Fill in the blanks with appropriate tense. I wish I did. Here the correct option will be fourth option, were. I wish I were dead. Question number 83. Find out the misspelled word. Here question is wrong. It should be correctly spelled word. So the correctly spelled word of monstrous is given in option first. The spelling is M-O-N-S-T-R-O-U-S. This spelling is correctly spelled here, which means distorted and unnatural in shape or size. In Hindi, it means Bhayanak, Rakshasi, Vishalkaya, etc. Okay, now question 84 to 86. We have to find out the error. So let's read the direction in the sentences given below. Question number 84 to 86. Mark the part which contains an error. If there is no error, mark 4 as your choice. Question number 84. Every one of us should do our duty to the country. So here the part that contains an error is second one. There should be his in place of our. Question number 85. Neither Ram nor his parents are to blame. Here the correct option is fourth one, no error. This sentence is correct. There is no error. Question number 86. Very few people now believe that the wages of sin are death. Here part third of the sentence contains an error. There should be is in place of are, as the noun wages is in singular number. Question number 87. Fill in the blanks with the correct preposition choosing from those given below. The cat is hiding us. Here the correct preposition will be from. So here option second is correct. The cat is hiding from us. Now question number 88. Choose the correct option to fill in the correct tense of the verb in the following. I waited for my friend until he, here the correct option is third one, came. The use of past indefinite tense will be appropriate here. Question number 89. Fill in the blanks. Silkworm feed mulberry trees. So here the correct option will be on. Silkworm feed on mulberry trees. Question number 90. Choose the correct transformation of the following sentence from complex to simple. While there is life, there is hope. The simple form of the given complex sentence will be second option, life and hope are inseparable. Question number 91. Fill in the blank with the correct preposition. I do not agree your proposal. Here the correct preposition will be to. Option third is correct here. I do not agree to your proposal. Question number 92. The word 40 means, here 40 means gupt, rahasmay, chori chipe. So correct meaning of 40 will be stealthy. S-T-E-A-L-T-H-Y, stealthy. Question number 93. Find out the correct meaning of stimulate. Here stimulate means uddipt karna. So the correct meaning of stimulate will be option 2, push. P-U-S-H, which means aage badhana. Question number 94. Perpetual means, so the word perpetual means anant, anvarat, chirasthai, ya sarvakalik. So here the correct meaning of perpetual will be third option, eternal. Okay, now let's see question number 95. The word disparity means, here the word disparity means inequality or difference in some respect. So the correct meaning of disparity from the given options will be first option, inequality. Question number 96. Chronicle plays were very popular in. So let me explain this. The Chronicle place had existed since 1580 and had become popular in 16th century. The patriotic tone in Chronicle place is carried on in Shakespeare's plays, which also exhibit a clearly defined philosophy of history. So here option 4th, 16th century will be the correct option. Chronicle plays were very popular in 16th century. Question number 97. Lyrical ballads was first published in, here the correct option is second option, 1798. Question number 98. A long romance entitled Endymion is written by, so Endymion is a poetic romance written by John Keats. It was first published in 1818. This poem begins with the line, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever." This poem is written in rhyming couplets in iambic pentameter. It represents the poet's first sustained attempt to explore the relationship between the real world of human experience and the ethereal world of an idealized existence. So your option 3rd will be correct, Keats. Question number 99. Robert Browning is famous for his, so Robert Browning was born on 7th May 1812 in Camberwell and died on 12th December 1889 in Venice, Kingdom of Italy. He was an English poet and playwright whose mastery of dramatic monologue made him one of the foremost Victorian poets. So here the right option will be 3rd option, dramatic monologue. Question number 100. T.S. Eliot declared himself to be a, so T.S. Eliot declared himself to be a Catholic. Actually, Eliot became a British subject in 1927 and there he converted to Anglicanism, and soon afterwards he encapsulated his views as classicist in literature, royalist in politics and Anglo-Catholic in religion. So here the correct option is 4th option, Catholic. Question number 101. Who said poetry is not a turning loose of emotion but an escape from emotion? So this has been said by T.S. Eliot when he was expressing his views on poetry. So your option 3rd will be correct, T.S. Eliot. Okay, now let's see question number 102. The phrase stream of consciousness was first used by, so the phrase stream of consciousness was first used in 1890 by William James in his book Principles of Psychology. So your option 2nd, William James, will be the correct option. Question number 103. In which poem does Tennyson commemorate his friend Arthur Hallam? So Tennyson commemorates his friend Arthur Hallam in his poem In Memoriam. Arthur Hallam, the best friend of Tennyson, died suddenly in 1833. Arthur Hallam and Tennyson first met at Cambridge, where they became member of the legendary intellectual club, the Apostles. Here option 3rd will be correct, In Memoriam. Question number 104. In which poem has Wordsworth described different moods of nature? So Wordsworth has described different moods of nature in the poem Lines Written a Few Miles Above Tintern Abbey. It was originally published in 1798. So your correct option will be 2nd option, Lines Written Above Tintern Abbey. Question number 105. Which of the following is not an essay by Charles Lamb? Here in the given options, Night fears, Christ Hospital and poor relation are essays by Charles Lamb, but Going on a Journey is an essay written by William Hazlitt. So your option third, Going on a Journey, will be the correct option. Question number 106. The idiom double dutch means, an incomprehensible talk or unintelligible language. So your option second is correct, unintelligible language. Question number 107. Choose the correct meaning of the following idiom out of the four responses given after it. So the idiom in cold blood means krurta purvak, jaan bujhkar ya nirdayata purvak. In a cold, unemotional manner. So here option second, deliberately, will be the correct option. Question number 108. What does the underlined expression mean? Every verdict that he gave was sui generis. Here sui generis means aditya. So option fourth will be correct, unique. Question number 109. That which stays for a long time is, here the correct option is third one, durable. That which stays for a long time is called durable. Question number 110. What does the idiom Penelope's web mean? The idiom Penelope's web means an unending work, anything which is perpetually doing but never done, an endless job. So your option third, an unending work, will be correct option. Question number 111. What is the meaning of the idiom ins and outs? So the idiom ins and outs means full details. So your option third will be correct, full details. Question number 112. The antonym of genuine is, so the antonym of genuine will be spurious. Option fourth is correct here, spurious. Question number 113. The antonym of volunteer is, the antonym of volunteer will be conscript. Here volunteer means in Hindi swayam sevak and conscript means jabran bharti kiya gaya sainik. So conscript is the antonym of volunteer. Question number 114. The antonym of agile is, so the antonym of agile will be slow. Option fourth is correct here. Question number 115. Give the correct antonym of the word prodigal. The correct antonym of the word prodigal will be frugal. Prodigal means atibyayi ya kharchila and frugal means alpvyayi ya mitvyayi. So your option third will be correct. Question number 116. The synonym of amnesty is, here amnesty means the formal act of liberating someone, means sarva chhama ya raj chhama. And the correct synonym of amnesty is given in option third, that is pardon. Okay. Question number 117. The synonym of adroit is, here adroit means quick or skillful or adept in action or thought. And the correct synonym of adroit is given in option first, that is skillful. Question number 118.
The synonym of felicitous, here felicitous means dhanya, anandprad, ya param sukhi. So the correct synonym from the given options will be convenient, means suvidhajanak, aramdayak, ya saral. Okay students, thank you for watching this video. I am working on some more videos related to TGT, PGT and UGC NET exams. So please keep in touch with me by subscribing this channel. Best of luck and have a great day.